Good morning and welcome. This is our special online church service that we hold each week. Thank you for joining us. If you're joining us for the first time, we hope that you're going to enjoy this service with us. If you have not done so already, we recommend that you subscribe to the channel and also like the service today so that it can be promoted on YouTube. Our first service follows a standard program where we start with the opening prayer, which is then followed by our worship songs. And then we have the speaking of life video, and then we give a short message on giving, which followed by a scripture reading and the message of the day. And then after that, we have the last worship song, and then the blessing at the end. So once again, thank you for joining us. Let's go into the service. We'll start with the opening prayer.
Good morning. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you today. We thank you for your love, your grace, and your protection. We praise you, Lord, for your limitless power and your good deeds. Please lead us through this service and nourish our hearts with your beautiful word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah! Let go. Have you ever been involved in a mistaken identity? Several years back, when I was working for Youth for Christ, I was in Denver, Colorado for ministry training. Some younger staff friends and I went into a specialty shop to pick up a few personal items. The shop owner happened to be minding the cash register. This shop owner was a tall, lean, athletic gentleman who was a bit older than me. I mentally flipped through my contacts and I came up with the name Alexander English, who had played his National Basketball Association career with the Denver Nuggets. I inquired if he was Alex, and he politely said, "No, I am Walter Davis." I begged his forgiveness. This was a deja vu experience for me because I met Walter when I was high school age. My teammates and I attended a college exhibition game in Asheville, North Carolina, when Walter was playing for the University of North Carolina. He did not play that day due to a high ankle sprain. He was sitting up in the bleachers by himself, and when we spotted him, we went over and got his autograph and chatted for a while. I reminded Walter about this occasion, and he remembered that day. Knowing who you are talking with is important. Have you ever considered how true this is when we are engaging in prayer? Our prayers will be shaped by who we believe we are praying to. Jesus certainly wanted his disciples to know that when they pray, they are praying to his Father and our Father. Jesus called him Abba Father, which indicates a deep and intimate relationship, an unbreakable bond Jesus shared with his Father. Before he taught them how to pray, he wanted to establish who they were praying to. The Psalms also engage in numerous reminders of who God is as it relates to praying. Listen to this link between prayer and the character and heart of the one they are praying to. Praise is due to you, O God in Zion, and to you shall vows be performed. O you who hear prayer, to you shall all flesh come. When iniquities prevail against me, you atone for our transgressions. Blessed is the one you choose and bring near to dwell in your courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of your house, the holiness of your temple. By awesome deeds, you answer us with righteousness, O God of our salvation, the hope of all the ends of the earth and of the farthest seas. The psalmist doesn't end there. It goes another 8 verses extolling who this God is who answers prayer. And there are many other psalms that do the same. When it comes to prayer, the psalmists obviously see the importance of being reminded of the identity of who they are praying to. What about you and me? We are told to pray unceasingly. Do we also seek unceasingly to know the Father who has been revealed in Jesus Christ? Do we call out to the one who hears our prayers, atones for our transgressions, and satisfies us with his goodness? Let's pray that we do. It will make all the difference in prayer when we know who we're talking with. I'm Greg Williams, speaking of life.
Hello everyone, this is Eva from the Polokwane congregation, and I'll be doing the offertory this morning. There's a saying that goes, actions speak louder than words. Allow me to tell you a very interesting giving story that I came across recently. It happened in a convenience store in New Orleans. A pastor just happened to be doing his shopping there, minding his own business, when he noticed a family of three struggling to pay for their items. So he felt a prompting inside to do something about that. So he approached the family and tapped the man on the shoulder from behind. He said to him, "You don't have to turn around, but please accept this gift from me and know that Jesus loves you very much." Then the story gets interesting because then 9 years later, after a church service, a pastor is approached by a man who wants to tell him the story about how he came to know Jesus as his Lord and Savior. He tells him about the convenience store incident, and he said, What the man didn't know was that very day, my family and I had a suicide pact. We were so poor, nothing was going well in our lives, and we decided to end it all. But then we had decided that before we do that, we are going to give our son his last meal to enjoy. So from the convenience store, they went straight to the suicide spot. When they got there, they gave the son his last meal, and then it was time to do the deed. But they couldn't go ahead with it. So they just sat there for hours, crying their lungs out, wondering what they were going to do next. But finally, they decided they were no longer going to end their lives, and they decided to go home. On their way home, they passed a church building, and then outside it was written, "Jesus loves you." And so the man got to think, well, there is that phrase again, "Jesus loves you. Who is this Jesus and what does he have to do with me?" So out of curiosity, they decided to go inside. To cut the long story short, they accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. So when the man was narrating the story to the pastor, he says to him, "I think that you are the man who gave me the money." How did he know that? The man was from South Africa and he had a distinct accent with him. That's what gave him away, and the man was able to identify him. And then as I was going through this story, I felt goosebumps, and it gave me a very warm and fuzzy feeling on the inside, because I got to think that, you know, sometimes I think what I'm giving is very little and it doesn't have much impact on anyone. But reading this story, I realized that even the little that we give, God has a plan for it, and it can go a very long way. Imagine if you knew that the money that you're going to give now was going to change somebody's life, because this pastor didn't only put a meal on their table, and not only did he save their lives, but he saved their soul. They were able to see the actions of God through him. He was the hands and feet of Jesus. So our little acts of obedience, they are not just that, they go a very long way. So this morning, as we are going to give, I just want us to remember that the little that you give is very significant. All you have to do is obey and plant the seed, and God will see to the growth. So I pray for you that as you give this morning, God can continue to bless you, because this story for me, it's a 100-fold return. So as you're going to give this morning, I pray that God can bless you more, so that you can continue to be a blessing and touch lives that you don't even get to know about. Have a happy Sunday ahead.
Everyone, my name is Rafetsa Slailo, and I will be doing your scripture reading for today. Our scripture is found in the book of Luke chapter 18, verse 9 to 14. The title of our scripture is "The Parable of the Pharisee and the Tax Collector." It reads as follows. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, "God, I thank you that I am not like the others, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood up at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves with the humbled, and those who humble themselves with the exalted. Thank you.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I greet you in this beautiful morning. I hope you may be knowing some people who struggle with pride, or you are that person yourself. Maybe you are married to someone who does not admit when he makes mistakes. Maybe you work for a boss who never makes mistakes in his life. Everything is always your fault. Maybe you have been wronged by someone whom you find it very difficult to forgive, because your pride does not allow you. Brothers and sisters, pride leads to comparison and lack of contentment. Pride can cause you to be inconsiderate. Pride causes you to trust your own thoughts rather than God's truth. It's so easy to look at others and see their pride and arrogance, but not so easy to see our own pride and arrogance. It's not so easy to see that we often hurt others out of our own pride. It's not so easy to see that we often harm our relationship with the Father because of our sinful pride that gets in the way. The sermon for today is based on the Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, verse 9 to 14. From this text, we are going to hear Jesus telling a parable to a group of people who thought they were something special. Luke does not tell us to whom Jesus told this parable, but it's not hard to imagine the scribes, the Pharisees, the elders being in the number. To those arrogant folks, Jesus had a message: God justifies the humble. to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. These were people who were full of pride, people who see themselves as the best. Luke chapter 18, verse 9 to 14 reads, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to the heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled. Those who humble themselves will be exalted. Who are you? The Pharisee? The tax collector? How do you go before God? This parable today is, it talks to you and me. This parable follows on the heels of another parable Jesus told of a persistent widow. Both stories are being used by Jesus to teach about prayer. But more importantly, what is being revealed is the character and heart of the one to whom we pray. And that will be an important perspective to hold on to as we go through this second parable that serves as the text for today. Otherwise, we may easily fall into the trap of doing exactly what the Pharisees does, measuring our righteousness by comparing ourselves to others. Jesus is not trying to teach us to copy the tax collector and shun the Pharisee. He wants us to see who his Father is to whom we pray. This will make all the difference in our prayer. And it will also make all the difference in how we understand this tale of two prayers. Parables often present a challenge to figure out what Jesus is trying to tell us. But Luke does a huge favor by telling us right up front why Jesus told this parable. Verse 9, he explains that the parable was told to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else. The parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector in the temple is rich with spiritual truth. In fact, it contains the very essence of the gospel of Jesus Christ. As verse 9 tells us, Jesus spoke this parable to those who trusted in themselves, that they were righteous and despised others. Jesus spoke often of the issue of righteousness, pleading with his hearers to understand their utter inability to be righteous enough to attain the kingdom of heaven. This acknowledge was essential. This knowledge was essential if they were to understand his mission on earth, which was to save sinners, those who knew they could not save themselves. The Pharisee, on the other hand, thought their own goodness was so impressive that it could not fail to make them acceptable to God. They held rigorously to the ceremonies and traditions of law, making a public show of their religiosity, all to see by other men, many of whom they despised and being beneath them. The Pharisee in the story is an example of one who is self-justifying. Notice that this prayer has no element of confession. The Pharisee's prayer has no element of confession. He does not ask forgiveness for his sins. Perhaps because he believes he has nothing to confess. Nor is there any word of praise or thanksgiving to God. His prayer is all about himself. He does not ask forgiveness at all. Maybe the reason is that he believes there's nothing to confess because all he does is good. Even the thanks he does offer is designed to exalt himself and place himself above others whom he treats with disrespect. Going to the temple to pray with that condition of his heart, as it was, he might as well have stayed home. Such a prayer is never heard by God. Unlike the Pharisee, the tax collector stood afar off, or at a distance, perhaps in an outer room, but certainly far from the Pharisee, who would have been offended by the nearness of this man. Tax collectors, because of their association with the hated Romans, were seen as traitors to Israel and were loathed and treated as outcasts. This man's posture, the tax collector, spoke of his unworthiness before God. Unable to even lift his eyes to heaven, the burden of his guilt and shame weighed heavily upon him, and the load he carried had come unbearable. Overcome by his transgressions, he beat his breast in sorrow and repentance and appeals to God for mercy. The prayer he speaks is the very one God is waiting to hear. And his attitude is exactly what God wants from all who come to him. The tax collector exhibits precisely what Jesus spoke about in the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are those poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Matthew chapter 5, verse 3. Being poor in spirit means admitting we have nothing to offer to God to atone for our sins. We come to God as empty, impoverished, despised, bankrupt, pitiable, desperate beggars. We must understand that righteousness comes from God, not us. Paul says that he wants to be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness which is from God by faith. Philippians chapter 3, verse 9. That doesn't mean there's no human response. It simply means that we understand the human response does not end salvation. Luke chapter 17, verse 10 reads, when you have done all those things which you are commanded, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done what was our duty to do. These folks also despised others. It shouldn't surprise us that they despised others. They saw themselves as the epitome of all that was good and right. A Pharisee and the tax collector go to the temple to pray. The Pharisee and the tax collectors are at polar opposite of Jewish society. The Pharisee was considered the most pious, the best of all possible people. Tax collectors were considered the worst. They were regarded as traitors to their own people. Verse 11 to 12, the Pharisee stands by himself. He is too good to be associated with anyone else in the temple, especially the tax collector who is there. He thanks God that he is not like other people. Jews considered it quite pious to thank God for their righteousness instead of trying to take credit for it themselves. Yes, the Pharisee is only using this thanksgiving to God as a way of showing God just how good he is. The Pharisee lists a group of people he's glad he's not like them. The sins listed here were considered among the worst in Jewish society. Then he mentions this tax collector. I know this is a parable and I cannot make too much of it. Yes, I've always wondered if this Pharisee did not make a point to be heard. He wants the tax collector to know just how good he is. The tax collector recognizes his sinful condition and seeks the only thing that can bridge the gap between himself and God. Have mercy on me. He cried. And we know from the end of the parable that God heard the prayer, his prayer for mercy, and answered it. Jesus tells us in verse 14 that the tax collector went away justified because he had humbled himself before God, confessing that no amount of works could save him from his sin, and that only God's mercy could. If we are truly brokenhearted over our sins, we can be assured of God's boundless love and forgiveness in Christ. He has promised in his word to accept us, to love us, to make us alive again through his Son. No amount of good works, church attendance, tithes or offerings, community service, loving our neighbors, or anything else we do is sufficient to take away the blot of sin and enable us to stand before a holy God on our own. That is why God sent Jesus to die on the cross. His death is the only work that is able to cleanse us and make us acceptable to God. However, David says he can't understand why God cares for us. Psalm chapter 3 8 verse 3 to 5. As you look at everything God has made, it is not absolutely amazing that God cares for us so deeply. This week, spend some time contemplating how small you are in the grand scheme of things. Spend some time gazing at the night sky and realize how big the universe is and how small you are. Watch the leaves change and fall. Realize you can't make leaves do that. You are a sinner responsible for the death of Jesus Christ. If ever there was a reason not to boast about our position, that would have been it. Jesus died because of us. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the God has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6. Matthew 26, verse 8 reads, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." Spend time this week contemplating Jesus' death. Go and read the gospel accounts of his torture and crucifixion. Remember, as you read that, it was taking place because of your sin. You need to save. There's nothing that is going to take away your pride more than saving someone else. Philippians chapter 2, 3 to 4. That's exactly how Jesus showed humility. The night he was betrayed, he took a towel and washed the disciples' feet. He went to the cross, not wishing to endure the torture, because he was submitting to the will of God and dying in our place. Here's what I want you to do. Find someone that you believe isn't nearly as good as you are. Someone who doesn't have as nice clothing. Someone who doesn't smell as nice. Someone who isn't quite as smart. I want you to find something you can do to save that person this week. That's precisely what Jesus did. He came to this earth and saved sin, sick, and dying people. If we want rid of arrogance, we will be a saving people. If we are humble, God will exalt us. How? Because if we are humble, we are receptive to the gospel of Jesus. You will submit to the will of God with a sincere heart. God will save you in the end. Thank you.
without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, poor wretched, blind, sight reaching, healing of the mind, yea, all I need in thee to find, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe. Of God, I come, I come, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come, I
Shall we pray? May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.
Two of my friends, actually. We're going to do this one.
Nandibonye popira horufu Gebala keise yama bita Mashiko rena cheso Pota tiwa ngagwana
obo tanziwa gamarofa angwa